Hello and welcome back to Classic Judging by the Cover, the series that's as last century as a stable and productive global diplomatic community, where we'll be judging Sid Meier's Pirates by the cover. Imagery-wise, you can't get much more straightforward than this. It's a game about pirates, and so there's a picture of a pirate ship. And in case any of those details slipped you by, this cover comes with a helpful guide pirate who will stand on the mast and point them out for you. Pirates! See? Pirates! Yeah! We didn't put a fucking skull on the flag because we're fans of the Grateful Dead. That's about it, really. Except to say I'm not sure why the figurehead was based on Cerberus the Aardvark, or why the trim is patterned like Harry Potter's scarf. Now, in all honesty, the imagery is kind of boring, which is why it's weird that all the text seems incredibly excited about it. First, they stuck an exclamation mark on the end of pirates, but it also looks like they were having enormous trouble containing themselves while they were trying to inscribe the P as well. Then there's the two taglines. The world's first swashbuckling simulation up top, and the action-adventure simulation at the bottom. Jeez, guys, make your bloody mind up. Did someone add the top tagline and then someone else said, well, maybe we shouldn't be so specific. Maybe there are people who want action-adventure but don't necessarily want swashbuckling. Oh, and by the way, the word simulation appears a third time, just underneath the MicroProse logo. I guess we know what was showing on the graphic designer's word of the day calendar. Anyway, I only showed you this, the UK Commodore Amiga version. Huh, I guess you'd expect a company called Commodore to be up for a nautical-themed game, thinking about it. So I could show you this, which was the US box art for the C64 version. You can see that they've finally settled on just pushing the action-adventure bit. It's funny that this scene is on the one hand more action-packed than the last one, but on the other, considerably more boring. I think it's the flat camera angle. The very hairy captain fights for his life but can't actually move about much because some merry prankster tied his left wrist to a cannon with a length of very thick rope. He fights a greasy underpants assassin, little realizing that behind him, another version of the greasy underpants assassin from a future timeline has arrived to ensure his past self's victory with the aid of a handheld miniature sailboat. Well, I suppose there could just be two underpants assassins with similar haircuts who swam over to the ship from a ship in the background, but that raises the question, which ship? The answer would recontextualize the whole image. Either they're from the intact pirate ship and are cocky with their recent victory, or they're from the sinking ship, need a ride, and are too proud to hitchhike. This cover also features the full title of the game, Sid Meier's Pirates, named after the developer, and what interests me is how Sid Meier seems to lose interest halfway through writing his signature. Sid Meier's! It's like he started signing, and then after the M, someone informed him that Electronic Arts was shutting down another of his companies. But again, I showed you this cover so I could show you this one. The alternate US C64 cover. Let's just contrast our two pirate captains here. The first, unshaven, sweaty, desperate, doing stuff, and generally looks like he has to fucking work for a living. And then you have this. This cleft-chinned, lily-white Disney prince in his dad's coat, holding his sword with hand on hip like he's saying, well, what do you expect me to do with this? Nice butter knife you've got in your belt there, surely. Maybe when your mortal enemy shows up, you'll have some letters you could open for him. No wonder his ship's pissing off without him. My point is, if your daughter brought the first pirate captain home, then sure you'd be dismayed, but at least you know she'd come back with some cracking tales of adventure at sea. Whereas all she'll come back with after adventures with this dude is self-esteem issues and a bill for her abortion. In all honesty, though, I showed you these two covers so I could show you this last one, for the Macintosh version, which depicts... Oh, look at his face! Look at the face on this fucking badass! And you know what really makes this is that blurb just to the right that says, Best of the Best! It's like the special ed student has been given a gold star sticker by the teacher, and odds are good he's going to be chewing on it by the end of the day. Best fantasy science fiction game? The only fantasy here is that this poor bugger's hat doesn't look like he stuck his head in a bin liner full of barbershop sweepings.